Hello, my friends, and welcome to this new class. We are going to talk about hips a lot, and I would like you to just take the time to be in a posture. Don't try to go too fast, because it's in going slowly that you work better. And we are going to talk about hips because we need to free the movement in hips, so it doesn't affect the pelvis every time we do something with our legs. And this is because it's stiff, or it's not stretched enough, or ligaments are not free enough. And it's very important to free the pelvis so we can have the pelvic zone normally without any tensions, additional tensions, and also the back, which is just dependent from the pelvis. So let's start. I hope you have already done the exercise with the ball and the inclined plane for the legs, and we are just going to start with a little bit of work in balance. So let's go. We are going to be in Tadasana, the mountain pose. Stay there, just feel the weight going in your legs. I think I don't have enough light. So stay there, heels on the floor. All the weight on the heels. And try to feel if it's the same in the right and in the leg side. Try to feel the zones of contact between the two legs, between the two heels, and also the pressure in the surface of the skin. And just stay there. Feel what's happening in your body. Just let breathing come naturally as it comes. See how this feels. Do you have any tendency to go in the left or in the right heel? Try to create the connection between the heels and the crown of the head. And you just stay there. We are going to talk about hips, the mobilization of the hip joint, and also stretching of the muscles that are around the hip joint. Feel if you have any differences in the right and in the leg side, and just be present in these differences if you have tensions that are different. We are going to need a chair for this session. Take a chair not far away from you. And we are going to start with a little work with the chair. It's an external rotation of the hip. The thigh is going to be parallel to the axis of the body, and the center of the mass is going to be over the heel that stays on the floor. Try to find balance in your leg. Push the big toe on the floor and push the heel on the floor to straighten your leg. Feel the back of your thigh that is trying to stretch the front of your thigh. Once you feel you are really balanced in your leg, you can take the other one on the chair, and you put the heel on the chair. You have to take a little bit of a distance from the chair so that your thigh is parallel to the axis. And this can start here. So this is going to help you work the mobilization of the hip joint. You can try to bring your arms both sides, palms up, elbows down. And you keep the connection between the heel and the crown of your head, and you stay there. Feel what's happening in your thigh. Try to push your knee away from your hip joint. Nothing is going to change. It's only an action that wants to bring your knee away from you. And you stay there. In this action. Let the shoulders lower down towards the back of your rib cage. And you stay there, you are active, you are in balance. Always keep the knee pushing away from you. Keep the big toe pushing the floor. The heel pushing the floor. Try to bring your elbows facing front, mate, but it's only a little action. It's not elbows facing front. It's from elbows facing down, just a little action of elbows facing front. And then you can come down, bring your foot close to the other one, and we are going to do once more the same thing with the same leg, but we are going to put it higher. You stay a little bit in a distance from the chair. Already there are differences between the two sides, but we are going to feel this later. Now we are just going to bring the heel on the chair again. And to find a good distance, you can move a little bit more to find the axis of your body on the foot that stays on the floor. There is going to be an external rotation in your hip. And you stay there, find the balance in your pelvis. Pelvis is going to stay in balance, horizontal and facing front. And you stay there. It's not necessary to do anything else. You push your heel on the floor to straighten your knee, but pay attention not to block your knee. And also you push your big toe on the floor to activate the inside of your thigh. And the other heel is just on the chair, and you push as well at the same way as before, your knee away from you, and you stay there. You can interlock your fingers, put your palms down in the back, and you let your elbows come towards the front. Before we prepare the next external rotation of the arms, and now we are in an internal rotation of the arms. To mobilize the joint between the arm and the shoulder. And you stay there, try to keep these activities, these actions, pushing your heel on the floor, pushing the big toe on the floor, to bring symmetry in the inner side and in the outer side of your knee. Both are long. To bring symmetry in the inner side of your thigh and in the outer side of your thigh. To bring as well symmetry in the front side of your thigh and in the back side of your thigh. And this in both legs. And you try to find this balance everywhere. Keep your pelvis horizontal and facing front. Try to create the connection between your heel and the crown of your head. And try to stay in balance. And just feel what's happening with your body. There is an internal rotation for the leg that is straight and an external rotation for the leg on the chair. And then we are going to come down and feel the differences between the two sides. Feel how your heels are on the floor, the pressure under the heels, the surface of contact. Feel the differences between the two ankles, the differences between the two knees, the two hips, and then we are going in the other side. Try to stay a little bit far from the chair to have enough place, and we are going to bring ourselves in a balance, but it's because I push myself towards my heel that the pelvis comes over my heel, and it's the pubic bone that comes over my heel. The other one, I'm going to grab the shin bone from the down towards the inside, and I'm going to put my heel on the chair and bring my thigh parallel to the axis of the body. And here you can also help yourselves with a little bit of manipulation of your muscles of the thigh. Just you make them turn a little bit from the inner to the outer side. And you stay there. Try to keep your pelvis in balance. And you start the actions as well. You push the heel on the floor, you push the big toe on the floor, and you push your knee away from you. And there you can just give time to the hip joint to turn a little bit, and it is going to need time. So stay active in the posture. Create the connection between your heel and the crown of your head. And just try to be posed in the posture. It's the posture that's going to create the channels of energy in your bed, in your body. And you stay there, you stay active. I'm going to stay in this side. You can start in the chair and in the lower part, or you can start right there. It's possible. It depends only in the mobility of your hip joint and in how much you have done this during your life, or how much you have the habit to use the hip joint in external rotation. And you stay there, keep the activity, create the connection between the heel and the crown of the head, push your knee away from you. And you stay in this activity. All postures are active normally. And activity is introduced by posture. It's not introduced by I want to do something. It's not by ego. It's introduced by reflex tonicity of the muscles. And you stay there, you are active. So this can be 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. It depends from everyone. It's important just to keep in mind that we don't violate anything in the body. We keep in mind to be gentle, to leave time, necessary time for this to happen. So we can repeat this more often in a week, to gain slowly more mobility and more freedom. And you stay there in this activity. Action of pushing the heel on the floor, action of pushing the big toe on the floor, action of pushing the heel, the knee away from you. And then we are going to come down. And I will do as well the other one, the other level. It's all right to do both. So you stay there away from the chair and you bring the heel only. And it's interesting, this thing, it's interesting because the weight of your leg is going to bring the external rotation in your hip. Keep the external side of your foot parallel to the axis of the body as well. And you stay. Feel what's happening in your body, feel what's happening in your hip joint. Do you feel any differences if you stop the action of the knee, for example, and if you restart the action of the knee? And you stay active, it's all right. And we are going to come down. You put both legs, the one next to the other, and you feel what's happening. You feel the differences again. So this external rotation is present in many postures. We have to prepare it for most of us. There is not any science behind this. Most of people don't use external rotation as much as we should. So we have to prepare it to be able to go to a posture that needs external rotation. We are going to stay with the chair anyway, but we are going to towards a posture which needs external rotation, as we said. We can use a chair or we can use a stick. We are going to turn 90 degrees the foot towards the exterior, and we are going to put the heel a little bit more towards the front. And we stay with the knee flexed. The other one, we let the heel go a little bit further towards the exterior, and we start by trying to bring the pelvis in an horizontal line. And already there, we have a lot of work to do to bring the pelvis in an horizontal line, and if possible, slowly facing front. And here we are in a preparation of the first warrior, but as well we are in a preparation of Uttita Parsvakonasana, which means I come, stretch all the side without creating compression in the other side. So maybe it's all right, you can do it like this, or maybe you bring your chair and you can just stay on the chair. Try to stay on the heels. And you just stay active like this. Stay on your heels, only try to keep the pelvis facing front. Let the shoulder come behind, and don't create any difference in the body, in the rib cage. So maybe this is like this or on the chair. All this is possible. Keep the shoulder down. Don't lift your shoulder. And like this, we can go to the other side in the same way. We need to push ourselves with the heel towards the other heel to come in a level, and then we can go in the other side. Feel a little bit the differences in the two hips. We are going to turn 90 degrees and lift the heel to bring it a little bit more towards the front. and the other heel, we are going to let it go a little bit further behind. And already we are going to start to create balance in the pelvis. So you bring your pelvis in an horizontal line. It's only by using the legs. It's because I push myself towards my front leg that the pelvis comes in an horizontal line. And as well, I try to bring myself with the pelvis facing front. To create balance, try to connect your coccyx, your coxal bone, with your tailbone, with the crown of your head. And you stay there active. And then we are going to try to create length in all the sides. And with the other hand, we can put the hand on the chair and stay there. Try to create length between all the vertebra. So this is a preparation, nevertheless, for Uttita Parsvakonasana, but as well for Uttita Trikonasana, the triangle pose. And try to create length. And if it's all right, we can come back. And go towards Trikonasana. So you stay there. You feel the differences between the two sides. You can use the chair for Trikonasana or just use a brick. I'm going to bring the bricks. It is interesting to start already with the chair and to start with not so much distance between the legs, because we don't have enough length in the inner thighs many times. So it's interesting to develop little by little in the posture. So you stay in a moderate distance between the two heels. And we are going to do the same. We are going to turn 90 degrees the foot, bring the heel a little bit more towards the front, let the other heel go a little bit further behind, and try to keep the pelvis facing front. I'm going to put the chair over here. And I'm going to try to just unbend my knee by pushing my heel towards the front. And I only want to unbend my knee slowly. So this question of unbending the knee slowly, it is going to make all the work. And just try to create little by little more external rotation in your thigh. So in your hip joint. You can hold yourself in your chair, or you can hold yourself on your thigh or on your shin bone. And little by little, very slowly, we try to unbend the knee. And you stay there, really slowly unbending the knee by pushing your heel towards the front. Pay attention to the back knee. It shouldn't be blocked. Stay with all the weight on your heels. Don't bring any weight in the front of the foot. And we want to create length in both sides of the body. So this is why I'm using the chair to stop me from descending very, very fast and too much. And I stay there. I am always trying to unbend my knee. Feel how it's changing in your hip joint. When you stay there, you try to unbend your knee always, always, always. There is this action only. You stay on your heels, you create the connection between your heels and the crown of your head. And you want to unbend your knee. That's all. Your other hand can come in the back and inside your thigh or in a vertical line like in the tree pose. And then you are going to come back in the center so you can help yourself with your chair to bring yourself up. And then you bring yourself in the center and you feel the difference in two sides. I will wake you up a little bit because I think we are almost sleeping. So stay on your heels, feel the differences between the two heels. I need a little bit more place for the chair. So feel the differences between the two knees, the two thighs, two sides of your belly. Two sides of your back, two sides of your neck. And then we are going in the other side, so we turn 90 degrees towards the chair. It's not going to be enough. And we are going to lift the knee to bring it towards the front and let the other heel go towards the back. We try to find balance in the pelvis. So this question of having a pelvis facing front and horizontal is going to influence the back and the belly. And then we are going to try to just unbend the knee. So I push my heel on the floor towards the wall and this is going to unbend my knee. And I just try to unbend my knee slowly. Feel what's happening in your pelvis. Do you have any differences already in the left and in the right side? In the back? In the front? And you can hold yourself on the chair. And drink a coffee like this. Yes, of course, why not? And you just keep pushing your you keep pushing your heel away towards the wall, and this is going to unbend your knee slowly. And it's only by doing it slowly that we realize the work that it's done by doing it slowly. And you stay there, you create connection between your heel and the crown of your head, which is not so easy. And you create you want to unbend your knee. So stay in the action of pushing your heel away towards the wall. And you can as well change position. If you can come really down, keep both sides long. No, I am just joking for the moment. I think I have never done this before. So just put your hand on the chair. Stay active with your shoulder. And you just create a connection between your hand, your heel, your back heel, and the crown of your head. Everything is connected. Try to find balance between all the activities. Feel the rotation in your hip. Stay really, really slow in your movement. And then we are going to come in the center. So you flex your knee because the other leg pushes you towards the wall. And you come in the center to feel what's happening in both sides. So you worked a little bit the external rotation and a little bit the flexion. So now we are going towards the flexion once more. A little bit of flexion is good for us. Stabilizes the back of the back, the back, but really the low back. So we can do this with the chair or with the stick. So you put yourself on your heels, you put the stick relatively away from you, and then you let your pelvis come towards the back. And this is what happens when we go towards the flexion, as we have spoken before. It's only because the pelvis comes towards the back that flexion happens, and you have to stay very, very attentive here to have what we have spoken before, a little very, very low lumbar lordosis. Then you stay there, you stay active, you create a connection between the crown of your head and the tailbone. You stay on your heels, feel if you are symmetrical, if there is the same weight in both heels, if your knees are both active and they are symmetrical, if your hips are both in the same dynamics, And you come down as much as you can, but really slowly. And you stay there. If your back starts to change, it's geometry. It's like if I have the stick and I put my stick behind me, I have to keep the same points of contact with the stick as I am bending towards the front. So if I stop here, it's all right. I can also stop there, I can stop there, but I don't change the shape of the back. And you come with the sticks, you stay like that as much as possible. This is going to work the lengthening of the back of your legs, but also the flexion in your hips. And then it depends from how much you have repeated this, how much you are going to flex towards the front. And we are going to come up. So flexion is interesting when you are with your feet together or with your feet apart. We have done that before. Maybe not with the chair. With the chair, it's this version. Maybe we have done it. It's this version where we try to just bring length in the back and stay in really, really in the side of the chair. But here, it's really slippery for me to go here for the moment. We can also stay with the knees bent a little bit. There are many people that have difficulties with hip flexion. This is an option. You stay on your heels and you push the big toes towards the floor and you try to find length towards the front. And this is only bending in the hip joints. And you can stop whenever you want. But this is a very good exercise to open your hip joints, but as well to create better flexion in your hip joints. You can come on the floor, you can keep a brick in front of you. This is going to be different option. This can also start just here. If I want to bring length towards the front, I have to resist with my heels, not to fall towards the front. This is why it's quite demanding for the legs. And we stay there. Try to create a connection between the crown of the head and the tailbone. And maybe it is going to be possible to bring your knees or your elbows in the inside of your knees. And you come in Namastasana. Keep all the weight on your heels, push the big toes towards the floor, and you stay active. This is similar to what we did the next week before, with the wall, the preparation in postures, sitting postures. But it's important to stay in the posture to experience what's happening in the body with this posture. And maybe one day we can be able to come up from the chair and slowly create more and more flexion in the legs. And we are going to come up. We don't need the chair anymore, so you can remove it. We are going to sit in the back of the heels. As much as possible, we remove the buttocks from the way. We bring them towards the back. And you sit in the back of the heels. And you start to feel a little bit what's happening in the body. We are going to cat postures. So we are going towards the front. We need to track a little bit the heels towards the ceiling. This is going to create a wave from the legs to the back, and this is going to help us bring the hands away from the body, and it is going to be sufficient. And then we are just going to push the feet on the floor to unbend the knees, and this is going to bring us towards the hands. The hands are going to resist. So the legs push me towards the front and the hands resist. It's two actions that find balance. I don't activate anything in my back and in my belly, neither. It's only actions in the hands and in the legs. And then I find balance and I stay there. And then I'm going to invert the actions. I'm going to track myself with my hands towards the front, and my knees are going to track me towards the back. I am tracking my mat towards me, and from the back I am tracking my mat towards the center. But this is not going to move, it's only an action. It's going to create more space in all the vertebra. You let your back free, you let your belly free. Feel what's happening in your respiration. Continue tracking yourself towards the front. And your knees want to bring you towards the back. 1 second. Yogi.
Yes,
I'm going to go to the
hospital. I'm going to go to
the hospital. I'm going
to go to the hospital.
Cut. Sorry. So we are going to continue where we were. Just continue tracking yourself towards the front and towards the back. We stay in the sections. And then we are just going to try to exhale really deeply. And in exhalation, it's like I want to bring out all the air I have in my lungs. And I try to exhale like I want to bark as a dog, but it's really, really slow. So I just make wah. And you continue tracking yourself towards the front and towards the back. Two more. And then you are going to push yourself towards your heels. Keep pushing yourself towards your heels. Feel the connection between the hands and the back. And then we are just going to try to bring the hands towards the front, keeping the pelvis a little bit in the back of the knees. So the knees are more towards my head than my pelvis. And I'm going to bring my elbows to the floor, my front on the floor. My front is pushing me towards the back, and my weight is pushing me towards the front. Push your elbows towards the floor to create more space in the armpits. And here again we are going to try to exhale deeply. And inhalation, you will just come in after the end of exhalation. Feel how your perineum is reacting with all this exercise. And you let in air in the end of exhalation. You don't inhale voluntarily. Air comes in. And then we are just going to bring the elbows really close to each other. Bring the palms of the hands towards the ceiling and push ourselves towards the back. You can just let your head rest on your arms. And you push yourself towards the back. If possible, you can bring your elbows even more towards the front. And you push yourself towards the back. Your knees can try to bring you towards the back as well. Try to just let a little bit of time. You can come a little bit towards your legs to put your head on the floor. Your elbows always stay on the floor and push you towards the back. But you just made some space for your head. And you stay there. You can repeat deep exhalation. Which will let inhalation be more complete and oxygen come into the body better. Two more. Then you can come towards the back and sit on your knees, on your heels. Feel what happened with this in your body, and then you can come down to Savasana. You can maybe attach your feet. Create a little bit of internal rotation in your hips. Let space for the lumbar lordosis to be present. You can grab the mat, both sides, and try to create a tension in the mat. This will just reposition your shoulders, and then you release everything. And you stay there to feel the experience of this session. Feel what's happening in your legs, in your ankles, in your knees, in your hips. Try to feel all the difference between the two sides. Give yourself some time to feel the differences between both sides. How is your pelvis on the floor? Feel the sensation in both knees, in in both heels, both shoulders, the arms, the forearms, the hands, the fingers, toes, the fingers, the toes. Create presence in all the body, all over the body. Create presence, be present. Even if there are places you don't find anything, this is even more important, to try to listen to these parts of the body that don't say anything. You find presence. By presence, you find energy and attention and conscience. So try to create presence everywhere you feel something and where you don't feel anything. And you can stay in Savasana as long as you want. I will just cut the video here. Sorry again for my neighbor. And